This podcast is brought to you by the School of Advanced Study, University of London. All of our podcasts are available from our website, www.sas.ac.uk.
Well, ladies and gentlemen, thank you so much for braving the elements to be with us for Professor Joseph Ayee's inaugural lecture as Emeka Anyaoku Visiting Chair in Commonwealth Studies. Welcome to you all. The Emeka Anyaoku Chair is a vital part of the Institute, and let me just say a little bit about its history. In 2001, the Institute launched a campaign under the patronage of the Duke of Westminster to endow a chair in Commonwealth Studies. The chair was to be named in honour of Chief Emeka Anyaoku, who served as Commonwealth Secretary General from 1990 to 2000. And it's a great pleasure to see some of the people who were intimately involved in that fundraising effort here today. Welcome to you all. The appeal succeeded in attracting the support from a variety of public and private benefactors, including the Federal Republic of Nigeria and three Nigerian state governments. These generous donations made possible the appointment of Professor Richard Cook as the first holder of the chair in September 2003, and in 2007 the chair passed to Professor James Maynard. Both Richard and Jim occupied the chair with great distinction, and it's a huge pleasure to have them with us today. I'm a bit worried about coming out with these dates, because I'm sure someone's going to contradict me at some stage, but so far so good. On Jim's retirement last year, we decided to reconfigure the chair as a visiting professorship, tenable for a period of up to 6 months. We felt that this would better reflect the Institute's key mission to promote and facilitate research in the area of Commonwealth Studies. It would enable a leading scholar from a non-UK Commonwealth country to spend some time in London, in the process advancing their own research, developing links with the UK higher education sector, and very importantly, enabling British scholars to benefit from the findings of their research. We were therefore absolutely delighted that Professor Joseph Ayee agreed to be our first Emeka Anyaoku Visiting Professor of Commonwealth Studies. He is an extremely worthy holder of the title. Professor Ayee is currently Rector of MountCrest University College in Accra in Ghana. Before that, he was Deputy Vice-Chancellor and Head of the College of Humanities at the University of KwaZulu-Natal in South Africa from 2010 to 2013. Professor Ayee is a highly respected and dauntingly prolific writer on the politics and public administration of Africa, with particular reference to Ghana. He is the author of no less than 7 books, including An Anatomy of Public Policy Implementation, Decentralization and Conflict, and my favorite title, Saints, Demons, Wizards and Systems, Explaining the Success or Failure of Public Policies and Programs. As we all know, the Commonwealth has more than its fair share of, dare I say it, saints, demons and wizards. So it's particularly appropriate that he should be our first visiting chair. A mark of Professor Ayee's distinction is that at the end of last month, he delivered the highly prestigious J.B. Dankar Memorial Lectures, organised by the Ghana Academy of Arts and Social Sciences, taking as his theme leadership and the Ghanaian state today, reflections and perspectives. And we're very proud that he brought the name of the Institute of Commonwealth Studies and the School of Advanced Study to Ghana in those highly successful and well-publicized lectures. And his title today is The Developmental State Experiment in Africa, The Experiences of Ghana and South Africa. Joseph A.
Thanks a lot, Director of the Institute of Commonwealth Studies. You know, colleagues, ladies and gentlemen, I deem it a great honor and privilege as the Emeka Anyaoku visiting Professor of Commonwealth Studies to deliver this inaugural lecture. I would like, therefore, to express my gratitude to the Institute of Commonwealth Studies for this honor and privilege. I'm also grateful to Chief Emeka Anyaoku, after whom the chair has been named in recognition to his distinguished career as Secretary General of the Commonwealth from 1990 to 2000. And of course, I'm also grateful to those who helped or assisted in setting up the chair. And I believe some of you are here this evening. Of course, I would like to appreciate the scholarship of my predecessors, Professor Richard Crook and Professor James Maynard, who serve as the Emeka Anyaoku Chair of Commonwealth Studies. And I'm proud that they are here this evening to witness this inaugural lecture. Last but not the least, I'm very grateful to Mr. Kweku Ansah-Asare, the founder of MountCrest University College in Ghana, who flew from Accra purposely to attend this lecture. And of course, if you are here, please, can you stand up for... And of course, to James Inokosha, the son-in-law, who drove him all the way from Cardiff. I'm indebted to all of you for coming in this rather chilly weather. Now, as has been pointed out, the title of the lecture is The Developmental State Experiment in Africa, The Experiences of Ghana and South Africa. And I've chosen the topic for a number of reasons. And I think that the first reason why I've chosen this topic is that if you look around Africa, the discourse has been development. And there are several strategies which have been designed and implemented to bring development to Africa. Indeed, if you look at the United Nations Economic Commission for Africa 2011 report, it identifies 8 strategies that have been designed and implemented to bring development to Africa. But these strategies have not worked out well. They have largely failed because of several reasons. Reasons like the fact that the policies were poorly implemented, reasons relating to neo-patrimonialism or patronage, reasons relating to poor policy design, reasons relating to policy discontinuity, reasons about slow industrialization, and of course, inadequate, conducive environment to promote development. So there are several reasons. And of course, the other reason is the fact that development in Africa has failed because of the inability of governments to grow a strong private sector. So there are several reasons that have contributed to the lack of development or slow progress of development in Africa. But I think the second reason that actually gave impetus to the choice of the topic is more or less the renewed interest in the paradigm of the developmental states. Now, so if you have 8 strategies which have not worked out, then of course you need to look at more or less a ninth strategy. And the ninth strategy has been the developmental state. And that the Asian tigers have actually developed because they have embraced the paradigm of the developmental state. So there has been renewed interest and a lot of discourse on the developmental state. And one of the things I want to do in this lecture is to actually make a contribution to the literature. The second reason why I have decided to choose the topic is that I have lived and worked in Ghana and South Africa. And therefore, more or less, I'll be talking from an insider's perspective about what has gone on in the developmental state paradigm, progress made in both Ghana and South Africa in regards to the developmental state. But of course, as an insider, I'm sure that I will not allow my judgment to be clouded. I'll be very objective as far as possible. A third reason, why have I chosen Ghana and South Africa? I've chosen Ghana for a number of reasons. Ghana is very unique in Africa. It is the first country in sub-Saharan Africa to have achieved independence in 1957. But Ghana saw a dip in its political and socioeconomic development from 1957 to about 1992. But even though it had suffered a dip in political and socioeconomic development, it actually designed and implemented a structural adjustment program which has been reputed as one of the best on the African continent. Indeed, Ghana became the star pupil of structural adjustment to the extent that the World Bank and IMF decided that other African countries should follow the Ghanaian example. And of course, the other thing which I've chosen, why I've chosen Ghana, is that it is one of the few African countries which have alternated governments. In 2001, the National Democratic Congress of Jerry Rawlings gave way to the new government of the new Patriotic Party under Kufuor. And then in 2009, there was an alternation of government where the new Patriotic Party of government of Kufuor handed over power to the National Democratic Congress. And so in terms of political development, in terms of democracy, Ghana is seen as one of the leading lights in Africa. And of course, the last one which I would like to mention here is that because of the democratic and economic credentials of Ghana, we've had visits from previous American governments. Previous American presidents had actually, almost two or three of them had visited Ghana because of what is termed the political and economic miracle. But one of the things that I would like to also flag here is that Ghana is not reputed to be a developmental state. It's not. But there are certain developmental indicators which it has achieved. For instance, the achievement of some of the objectives of the Millennium Development Goals. For instance, poverty reduction, even though we ourselves we are saying that we are not there yet, there has been an effort to reduce poverty, there has been an effort to increase enrollment targets, and maternal mortality has also been increased. So these are the reasons that have informed my choice of Ghana as a case study. I've chosen South Africa also for a number of reasons. The first one is just South Africa is regarded as a giant. It's regarded as a big brother. It's regarded as the most industrialized country in Africa. is regarded as having a strong private sector. It's regarded as a country which has more or less one of the most vibrant one of the most vibrant trade unions, the COSATU. It's regarded as one of the countries which, with a vibrant and unified political party, in spite of few cracks within the African National Congress. And then, of course, I've chosen South Africa because it has been termed in different forms about its ability to become a developmental state. Some people say that South Africa is a developmental state in waiting. Others say it is an emerging developmental state, whilst others say it is a developmental state in the making. And indeed, if you look at official documents of South Africa, by the ANC, and of course, if you look at the National Development Plan of 2012 to 2030, there is a whole chapter devoted to the developmental state entitled Building a Capable and Developmental State. And that is one of the few countries which has official documents actually saying that we would like to be a developmental state. So my choice is informed by the fact that South Africa is more or less a developmental state in the waiting, and then of course the fact that it has this idea of a developmental state has been expressed in official documents. Now I just want to move on to what is a developmental state and the state of the art, and I'm not going to be here for too long. There has been a wealth of scholarship which has built up about the developmental state. I mean, if you look at the writings of Chalmers Jones, 1982 to date, we have a lot of scholarship built around it. And the scholarship can be divided into two. The first set of scholarship will look at the two schools of thought which have emerged about the developmental state. And the second set of literature relates to the five viewpoints about the developmental state. And I would like to take the two schools of thought first. The two schools of thought about the developmental state are the political school and the economic school. The political school indicates that state capacity is important to bring development. Without the capacity of the state, there cannot be any development. And then, of course, so the legitimacy of the state depends on its ability to bring development. The economic school of thought postulates that in any developmental state, you need economic policies and programs which will bring development. So emphasis is placed on removing market imperfections so that you can fix those market imperfections, or you can build some institutions which will be able to redress those market imperfections. And I think that it is very important that if you look at the developmental state, you are dealing with the political issues and, of course, the economic issues. But those political and economic issues must be dealt in it within the confines of the linkage between national and international actors. Now, I don't want to bore you with the various definitions, but of course, there are several definitions of the developmental state. But to this paper, a developmental state refers to a state which has the capacity to promote development and link that development to national and international actors. Even scholars have not actually agreed on the definition of a developmental state. But to me, or to this paper, if you are looking at a developmental state, you are looking at a state which has the capacity to promote the development and use the development to connect with local and international stakeholders. Now, I just want to look at the five viewpoints about the developmental stage. The first one, which has been more or less made pronounced, is the fact that the paradigm of the developmental stage is not alien to Africa. That if you look at African countries after independence, Ghana under Nkrumah, Tanzania under Julius Nyerere, then of course Zambia under Kaunda, and then Senegal under Leopold Senghor, these leaders have espoused developmental vision about their countries. So because of this, some scholars have said that, look, the idea of developmental state is bogus, it's not new to Africa, we've had developmental states. But I have tended to disagree with them, because if you are talking about the developmental vision of Kwame Nkrumah, Julius Nyerere, Leopold Senghor, and Kenneth Kaunda, they have not led Africa to the paradigm of developmental states. What we had during those periods, what we had was more or less statist policies without industrialization, or little or no industrialization. And so to me, and then of course the other thing is the fact that we have patronage, we have rent-seeking activities, statist policies, which did not actually promote development. So if you tell me that in Africa we had developmental states, I'm a bit cautious because of this, because the promotion of the developmental vision of these leaders did not make their countries quote and unquote developmental states. The second viewpoint which has been raised is the fact that, well, we don't need developmental states in Africa, we need democratic developmental states. And the argument is that if you look at the Asian tigers, Singapore, Indonesia, China, all of them, they only promoted development, but they did not take account of the political issues. That the political regime was not necessary. Indeed, the Asian tigers, the political regimes of the Asian tigers were dictatorial, authoritarian. And so what we need in Africa rather is democratic developmental states and not the developmental states we had in Asia, where you had the countries living under authoritarian regimes. The third view of the developmental state is the fact that the developmental state is no longer relevant. It is archaic, it is dead, and the reason is that the developmental state was not able to deal with the Asian economic crisis in 2000 and the global crisis of 2008. So if the paradigm has not been able to resolve those global crises, then we don't need, African countries do not have any business relating to the concept. The fourth viewpoint, which has been raised, only pointed at gaps in the literature. For instance, now if you look at the developmental state literature, the tendency is to address the capacity of the state but not its motivations. And people actually indicated that, well, if you are dealing with the state, then of course you should not deal only with the capacity of the state, but of course with the motivations, motivations. And then of course, if you also look at the literature on the developmental state, emphasis was put on the depoliticization of the bureaucracy. And the argument which has been made is that you cannot, in any context, within the context of Africa, within the context of any state, the depolitization of the bureaucracy is a myth. So what we need to do is to also take into account both competence and then, of course, partisan considerations in appointing people. So the so-called myth of a depoliticized bureaucracy as envisaged in the developmental state cannot actually hold. And then, of course, the final one is the fact that the developmental state is not a sustainable paradigm, that it comes and goes depending on the country, depending on the context, depending on several factors. And the fifth viewpoint, which I want to leave with you, is that we cannot have developmental state in Africa because of certain negative things that are in African countries. And they are mentioned: rent-seeking activities, lack of commitment to development, neo-patrimonialism, inadequate human resources, and the fact that state intervention in the economy has become redundant and irrelevant. So you can, because of globalization. So what is the whole big issue about the developmental state? But to me, as far as I am concerned, and as far as the literature, part of the literature is concerned, it seems that there has been this renewed interest in the developmental state, and indeed, in the writings of Peter Evans, he has made a very important point that if the developmental state is important to the 20th century state, then it is equally more important to the 21st century states. But apart from that, on the African context, the Economic Commission for Africa's report on Africa in 2011 actually made a plea to African countries to embrace the idea of the developmental state because it is the way forward to transform African economies and make them more relevant to their societies. So based on this, based on the United Nations Economic Commission for Africa's report, based on part of the literature which has emphasized the importance of the developmental state, I now proceed to look at to what extent have Ghana and South Africa promoted some of the features of the developmental state. And here I'm going to look at seven features of the developmental state and find out the progress which Ghana and South Africa made towards the realization of the developmental state. Now, and I'm going to do this by looking at the seven features of the developmental state. If you read the literature on the developmental state, there again is no agreement on which features are important or not. But there's agreement on four of the features which are important. The first one is you need a political leadership which has a developmental vision. That one, there's agreement. A political leadership with a developmental vision. The second one is a capable and autonomous bureaucracy, which means that the bureaucracy must be depoliticized. The third one is the fact that there must be a symbiotic relationship between the bureaucracy and, of course, the private sector. And then, of course, the fourth one is that there must be policy interventions which will promote economic growth. To me, looking at the literature, looking at the pros and cons of the literature, I've decided to build on these four features of the development of the developmental state and come up with seven features which I think are relevant in explaining the progress made by Ghana and South Africa with regards to the developmental state. The first feature that I would like to use to evaluate progress made relates to transformational or developmental oriented leadership. Do we have this in Ghana or South Africa? And over here, I would like to say that Ghana and South Africa have had two great leaders, Kwame Nkrumah in Ghana and Nelson Mandela in South Africa. These are, to me, development-oriented, transformational leaders. And in spite of their vision, developmental vision, the vision to unite the country, to bring development, these leaders had weaknesses. In Ghana, for instance, Kwame Nkrumah was authoritarian, was dictatorial, and did not even give a free hand to the bureaucracy to actually operate. If you look at Mandela, on the other hand, within the 4 years, of course, people say that the 4 years not enough for him. He was not able to bring the inequality and then, of course, provide the public services in the township in South Africa, the poor township. So people blame him for not being able to redress the inequalities or inequities and then, of course, provide basic services to poor black townships. But to me, I think that 4 years not enough for a leader to redress the imbalance of apartheid. So we have two great leaders. It seems to me that after these two great leaders, Ghana and South Africa, we've not had leaders who have matched up to their stature, who have been development oriented, who have been able to have that development vision to carry their countries forward. And I think, to me, it seems that leadership in these two countries have been bedeviled by several weaknesses. The first one is that I think leadership in the two countries have not made hard choices and decisions. What we have seen, if you look at policies, if you follow policies and programs of the leaders, the policies were mainly ad hoc, mainly piecemeal, not coordinated, mainly politically motivated, just to actually gain legitimacy, and then that's it. Consistency in policy, hard choices, have not become the order of the day in these countries. And I think even to the extent that I think I'll give examples here. If you go to South Africa, they have a policy called transformation. Transformation means that you replace whites with qualified Africans. It does not say unqualified Africans. But if you look at the way the policy was implemented, most often than not, you see unqualified Africans being promoted to take over from qualified whites. But if you look at the essence of the policy itself, is that there must be a gradual replacement of qualified blacks, of qualified whites, with qualified blacks. If you go to Ghana, there has been discontinuity of policies and programs. Even policies which are meant, which have been doing well. I mean, so the example of, if you follow the news in Ghana, we have a big problem now with judgment debts, the payment of judgment debts, where governments were supposed to pay huge debts to people who the courts had decided that they should be paid monies. But if you look at it, even getting records on some of these judgments have become problematic. Why? Under the new Patriotic Party government, there was a filing system which would track all this. When the NDC government came to power in 2001, a simple process of this filing system was more or less discontinued. So the point I want to raise is that simple things, policy discontinuity, and meanwhile, the Ghanaian constitution has indicated that governments must, as far as practicable, follow policies and programs of their predecessor governments. So the point I want to raise here is that we have problems with governments making hard choices, sticking to policies which are good, and trying to actually forge development. The second issue, why I said Ghana, the shoes of Kwame Nkrumah and Nelson Mandela are too huge for succeeding leaders to wear, is the fact that systemic corruption has been the order of the day. And it has been to the extent that in 2012, if you look at the corruption perception index, Ghana was ranked 64th. South Africa was ranked 69. And if you follow closely, there has been a consistent drop in the corruption perception index. So the leaders are interested in stamping out corruption, but the argument is that they have more or less not that they have not the commitment to do so. And to the extent that the leaders will say that, well, if any citizen has a cause to complain about being corrupt, they should go and report them. Who in Africa, which citizen in Africa will go and report the head of state to maybe the, in South Africa it's called the public protector. In Ghana it's called the Commissioner of Human Rights Administrative Justice. How many citizens will have the guts to go and say that, well, leader A, B, C, and D, they are corrupt, so they should be investigated? The point I want to raise is that the eradication of corruption has become a public relations hoax by the leaders. And so there has been this consistent systemic corruption in these two countries. The building of patronage has always been there. The office of president in the two countries have actually overgrown in size. Why is that so? People want to reward their political friends and allies, etc., etc. The management of the economy has always been problematic. Admittedly, I'll say that the two governments, if you look at Ghana and South Africa, there have been several state of the nation addresses, several development plans, which show that the leaders have had the commitment to actually manage the economy. In the budget statements, efforts have been made to actually address some of these issues. But again, as one would have pointed out, the economy of these two countries the economies have not actually made progress. For instance, in South Africa, the debt to gross domestic product ratio for 2012 is 38%. Whilst in Ghana, the debt to GDP ratio in December 2012 is 49.4%. 49.4% in Ghana and 38% in South Africa. Meanwhile, I'll come and argue later that the developmental state, the idea of a developmental state, also hinges on a very robust fiscal foundation for the states. But so if these two countries, if the economies are not robust, how can we achieve developmental states? Of course, if you look at the Auditor General's report of the two countries, there are instances of malfeasance in several areas, financial misconduct and malfeasance. Now, from these weaknesses, it seems to me that it's clear that the two countries have not exhibited what we call transformational leadership, but what has been called transactional leadership, patronage, rewarding activists, ad hoc policies and programs, trying to gain legitimacy but not taking drastic measures, drastic policies, which would actually promote a development. Now, but having said so, I would like to say here that if you look at the policies and the plans, they have contained in them very important issues about a developmental vision, etc., etc. Now let me just now move on to the state autonomy as the second feature. And it's over here we want to look at, has the state got the capacity to design and formulate policies and programs? Are the policies being owned by the governments, or what is called policy ownership? To what extent have the policies been actually debated by civil society organizations? Because if you are talking about state autonomy, you're also talking about, has the state got the capacity to interact with stakeholders to refine policies, etc., etc. And what I would like to state here is that if you look at the two countries, efforts are being made to involve stakeholder participation in the policy process. If you look at the legislative, the legislatures in both countries, all the committees of the legislature would have invited stakeholders to send memoranda to the various committees. If you look at civil society organizations, they've also involved in policy refinement, etc. So there has been some effort in this area to actually involve policymakers and refine policies and programs. But the point is that in the literature, it becomes difficult to identify to what extent have civil society organizations or other organizations, to what extent have they influenced the outcome of the policy. It's not clear. If you look at the cases of Ghana and South Africa, where they will tell you that if it's education, we have involved schools, we have involved other stakeholders in the process. But to what extent, if it is education, to what extent have they been able to refine or fine-tune or make inputs to public policies and programs? It's not clear in the literature. And also, if you are dealing with non-state actors, have state institutions been able to accommodate non-state actors? In the experiences of Ghana and South Africa, there is evidence to suggest that if non-state actors will want to be very proactive, very more or less aggressive in cause, they are not more or less liked by the state institutions, because the state institutions are always not sure whether the non-state actors are on their side or not. And this has therefore led to some attempts in Ghana and South Africa to co-opt some of the non-state actors. And of course, if the attempt is made to co-opt you, then of course, and you have not been able to agree, of course you are labeled as an anti-government, non-state actor. Now, I would say that it seems to me that the policy process has evolved in these countries, and so there are several ways of consulting. One of them is the fact that leaders have decided to go to the public and ask for their views. In Ghana, it's called the People's Assembly. The president, once a year, will go to a village or will go to town and meet the public, answer questions. Of course, to what extent have these been able to fit into public policy? In South Africa, it is the same. They call it Nzibizo, meaning public gatherings, where leaders at both national, provincial, and local government levels would actually hold public gatherings and ask for views about people. But if you're asking for views about people, sometimes how do you measure is it being fed into the policy process? It's very difficult to say so. But overall, in spite of these problems, I think that the two constitutions, the 1992 constitution and the 1996 South African constitution, have laid the basis for the interaction between state institutions and non-state institutions. It's a question of how do they come together. The other point I would like to stress is the fact that is there a relationship between the state institutions and non-state institutions? Sometimes they are not there. In certain areas, they are there. But the point is that we need to actually deepen this interaction, and which will enable public policies and programs to be fine-tuned for development. I now move on to the third feature, which is the developmental public administration or public service. Indeed, this just means how do you strike a balance between the appointment of competent people and partisan considerations? And it seems to me that the two countries have not been able to manage the balance well. It seems that the scale has tilted more to political considerations being taken into account in making most appointments. It's a big issue because in certain areas, yes, appointments are based on competence. But in most cases, how do you balance? And some scholars have made the point that when we are talking about a depoliticized public service, we are at the same time referring to the proper balance between political considerations and competence. But from what I've seen, there has been more of political appointments rather than a combination of competence and political consideration. Now, I'll give examples. The two countries have introduced what is called the new public management reforms. Privatization, decentralization, financial reforms, agentification, etc. And in the case of South Africa has introduced what is called the Senior Management Service, the SMS. Ghana has not. The two countries have introduced contract appointments. But you see, the idea of a senior management service is based on the US model of appointing competent people, but at the same time with some partisan leanings. But if you look at appointments to the South African public service, there are more of political appointments and not the balance between the two. Again, if you look at the Ghanaian context, several studies have shown that the balance between competence and political affiliation has not actually been part of the appointment, to the extent that politicization has become very rampant. And the new public management reforms were supposed actually to do away or minimize the politicization of the public service. And I think that part of the developmental state is the fact that how do you ensure a depoliticized public service? And to me, a depoliticized public service would be competence and political affiliation. Others will say, no, let us look at competence. But within the context of Africa, within the context, I still believe that the proper balance between the two must be struck. I'll now move on to the fourth feature, which is production-oriented private sector. I've made the point earlier on that South Africa is reputed to be more or less a country with the strongest private sector. And it has been pointed out, indeed, Ben Fine has made a very important point that the South African economy is dominated by a minerals energy complex, which has forged a relationship between the state and private capital. It's a very important point, and because, why is that so? Because South Africa has conglomerates, especially in the mining sector. So that alliance has been there. So it's a very important issue. If you look at, so policies have been implemented to actually create an enabling environment for the private sector, to the extent that the ANC government has a policy to promote black empowerment. Black empowerment, which is a very important policy, which actually is to create a black African entrepreneurial class. It's a very important one. So there has been that encouragement. But of course, the black empowerment strategy has also been criticized because it has not actually benefited the country as it should. And if you look at the literature, some of the scholars have indicated that it has actually become a way of promoting or building patronage in the country. So yes, we have a strong relationship between the state and private capital in South Africa. But to what extent has this been transformed to development? I'll answer that later. Now let me come to the Ghanaian context. If you look at all the policy documents, all the speeches of the leaders, there has been the emphasis to create the enabling environment for the private sector. Indeed, some of the governments even introduced what they call a business-friendly year, declared 2003, the new Patriotic Party government of President Kufuor in 2003 declared that year a business-friendly year, or even policies on the golden age of business, or even the presidential initiative on cassava, agriculture, etc., etc. So there has been that effort to actually create the enabling environment. But you see, it's one thing saying these things, is the other thing is how do you implement them? And if you look at Ghana and South Africa, they share a common experience. Ghana hasn't got a strong private sector. It's true, it's been acknowledged even by government publications. It's been acknowledged by government leaders. South Africa, on the other hand, has a strong private sector. But to what extent has the private sector been used as an engine of growth? If you look at the South African economy, it's more or less growing, but not actually benefiting the majority of the people. And I think that's the most important point. If you look again at the private sector in Ghana, it's very slow, but not benefiting the majority of the people. But the point which I want to stress here is that even though the governments are interested in creating an enabling environment for the private sector, the very good things or the very positive things which will make the private sector grow are not actually there. A classic example is infrastructure, water, electricity. In 2010, South Africa did not have electricity, did not have water in the townships, did not have electricity in the townships. In 2012 in Ghana, there has been, since 2012 or even previously, electricity, there has been constant load shedding for the past 10 years. Other times you say, oh, 1 year is good, the other year load shedding. And since last year, August, there has been consistent load shedding throughout. It has been aggravated by inadequate water supply, intermittent actually. And these two key things, water and electricity, are important to the private sector are important for industrialization. And if you want to be a developmental state, water doesn't run, electricity is intermittent, then of course you cannot, you are far away from the paradigm of the developmental states. And I think that when we are thinking about industrialization, these little things, water, electricity, very important. The fifth one, effective national development planning. Again, if you look at the literature, all the two countries have actually developed plans, but unlike in the case of South Africa, it has a comprehensive development plan. Ghana has not had any comprehensive development plan since independence, apart from Vision 2020. All the plans were medium-term plans. But South Africa has a plan, a comprehensive plan, which is called, which will end in 2030. So the point is that comprehensive planning is important to any country. And I think this is where Ghana has failed. South Africa has taken the lead in this matter. And of course, with plans, you need a strong institution. In South Africa, the institution is called the National Planning Commission. In Ghana, the institution for planning is called the National Development Planning Commission. Now, if you look at the composition of the membership, the National Planning Commission of South Africa has 26 members. In Ghana, the National Development Planning Commission has 37 members. The National Planning Commission of South Africa is not a presidential body, or it doesn't function under the office of the president, even though it is headed by a minister at the presidency, Trevor Manuel. In Ghana, the National Development Planning Commission is a unit under the office of the president. It actually reports to the office of the president. It is supposed actually to advise the president. Now, if you look at the literature, the impression one gets is that these planning commissions are not insulated from partisan politics. Even some, in the case of Ghana, never-do-well politicians are damned to the National Development Planning Commission. Where you, it's more or less, the perception is that it's more or less like a Siberia. If you have fallen out of favor with the government, they put you there as a member of the commission. So the point I want to stress here is that, yes, we have plans, medium-term plans, comprehensive plans, long-term plans in the two countries, but again, implementation is not as good as one would have been expected. And then, of course, the institutions are not strong enough. The capacity of the institution to implement has not been as strong as one would have expected. The sixth one feature I'd like to deal with is the expansion of human capacity. This is a very important issue, that if you are talking about human capacity, you are talking about capacity building for state institutions. You are talking about infrastructure. You are talking about education. You are talking about health. You are talking about the achievement of the Millennium Development Goals. Now, if you look at the two countries, it seems that Ghana's progress towards the achievement of the Millennium Development Goals, Ghana's progress is a little bit better than South Africa, because one, in terms of poverty reduction, Ghana has actually moved ahead by 5%. In terms of enrollment targets, Ghana has actually schools, more enrollments, etc., etc. But these are not as good. The progress towards the achievement of the Millennium Development Goals in South Africa has not been as strong as the one we have in Ghana. But I've talked about all this, but the most important one which I want to flag in terms of human capacity building is the ability to conduct research. And this is where, again, Ghana and South Africa will differ. In South Africa, the country has what we call the National Research Foundation, which actually rates researchers. You apply and you are rated A, B, C, you know, and every year you get money because you are rated researcher. So there is money available for research. There is emphasis on PhD, production of PhDs. The reverse is rather, and of course, PhDs in some universities, they get scholarship or fellowships. In Ghana, it is the reverse. Indeed, there is no state funding for research in Ghana, unlike in South Africa. In addition to this, state institutions are charging more for postgraduate studies. That's also a disincentive for postgraduate studies. So the point I want to stress is that if you look at Japan, if you look at Singapore, the developmental state was achieved through massive research, massive injection of funds to support institutions, universities, research institutions to promote research. But in the case of Ghana, research has been at no state funding for research. Of course, we have research institutions in Ghana, but they, unlike the South African Research Foundation, which actually raise researchers and gives them money to conduct research, the case has not been in Ghana. So I think that when we are talking about expansion of human capacity, we should also be talking about how do we fund research in these countries. Finally, the seventh one is good governance. And this is an everyday song in the donor agenda, so I don't want to sing it too much. But the point is that transparency, accountability, all these features are very important. And if you look at the 1992 Ghanaian Constitution and the 1996 Ghanaian Constitution, they are clear on this, that you must have a framework, or the requirements of good governance are important in achieving development. Progress again made, but there are what I call good governance deficits in the two countries. And I just want to list a few of them. The first one is the crime and the polarization of society, especially in South Africa. There is crime in Ghana, there is polarization of society in Ghana, but South Africa ranks higher than Ghana in terms of crime and polarization. The second one is the fact that there is always, if you read the literature, lack of coordination between or among state institutions. I mean, they are supposed to do the same thing. They are not doing well. I mean, it becomes a big problem. I have indicated to you that in Ghana, there is load shedding for when it comes to electricity. But there are six institutions which have to produce electricity in Ghana. They have not been able to do that. And all of them are blaming. They are blaming each other. The problem with lies with you. In South Africa, Eskom is the only institution which produces electricity. But at least, in terms of comparison, South Africa's energy problem is not as bad as Ghana. One institution doing these six institutions in Ghana not actually doing their work. So the point on lack of coordination in several areas has been stated. Then, of course, we have the inadequate provision of basic services, just like sanitation. It's a basic common thing. Richard and I have looked at sanitation issues in Ghana. And the verdict which came out is that the findings are clear that the basic thing which any town, city in Ghana will need has not been performed. So there has been a wholesale condemnation of the public services for not being able to deliver. And then, of course, I would like to touch on the issue of the excessive use of force by the police. It's not only in South Africa, but also in Ghana. There are several good governance deficits in these countries. I've listed here 14 of them. I don't want to go into details in all of them. So what I want to say is that if there are infractions on good governance, the governments have taken steps to redress them or to address them, but one would have thought that there will be a consistent way of dealing with the issues. Now, what is my conclusion of all this? Well, from what I've said so far, I'm sure all of you are saying that, but have we made progress or we have not made progress? I see some of you are, or where are we? Do we need it or do we not, or we do not need it? I think that the two countries have made what I call modest progress with regards to the developmental state. And I will say that the road to the developmental state in these two countries has been slow and bumpy, even though South Africa's progress from available evidence seems better than that of Ghana. I've also not painted a big picture of the progress, but one thing that I would like to say is that the achieving the status of a developmental state is not an end in itself, but a means to an end. I think we must get this message clear, that the developmental state paradigm is not an end in itself, but a means to an end. And there is a note of optimism because there is the recognition in both Ghana and South Africa that more work needs to be done if the dream of a developmental state is to be achieved. Now, so what can the two countries do? What can they do to speed up or to deepen the developmental state process? I've listed four of them here, but five of them, sorry. The first one is that there should be the realization on the part of the key players that building a developmental state is an expensive venture and depends on the robustness of the fiscal foundation of the state. The fiscal foundation of the two states, especially Ghana, is weak, as reflected in the high level of debt to GDP ratio, and as a result, the resources are not available for a significant state-led developmental initiative. The second thing I would like to stress here is that political leadership in both countries should be reminded that they enjoy the support of the citizens because they are associated with promoting rapid economic growth and providing economic benefits to both the ruling elites and to the general citizenry. You know, consequently, the leaders must demonstrate a genuine commitment to development. And I think that's the key word, a genuine commitment to development, a commitment to reduce poverty and to begin to address concerns about transforming the economy and then, of course, industrializing. If you look at the two countries, industrialization has lagged. Ghana is behind South Africa. South Africa is moving, but it needs to be gingered. It needs to be actually transformed. So industrialization is very important, and the leaders must know right away. Even though I'm sure those of us here will say that, well, the leaders know, it's one thing knowing, is the other thing is how to implement. That's the key thing. The third issue, which is dear to my heart, is capacity building for state institutions. Not only capacity building, if you are talking about capacity building, we also say that you must make resources available to the institutions to do their work. And I think quite often we get carried away when we talk about capacity building, training sessions, taking people out for one week, 3 weeks, maybe in a posh hotel, they come back, train them with ideas, they don't have the resources to implement those things. So I think that getting resources, capacity building must also include giving resources to the institutions to work. And of course, if these things are done, why not? Service delivery will have improved, because to me, as a student of public administration, I'm interested in how are services delivered to everybody. Because if you go to countries, they are talking about sanitation, they are talking about water, they are talking about electricity, they are talking about basic public services. So capacity building, very important. And the third issue, the fourth one, which I also want to flag, is that whether we like it or not, development is a political process. This may seem a truism, but This is often forgotten. And I think that's why when we are talking about the developmental state, we should be talking about how everybody sees development. People must be able to see what is development and how do they link up with local and international actors to actually forge a common front to pursue development. And finally, I would like to say that the developmental state agenda in the two countries will need to be consolidated. And one of the things that we need to do is that we must vigorously implement the requirements of good governance. Because without good governance, without leaders not becoming too parochial, not becoming corrupt, not building patronage, without the leaders not trying to adhere to good governance, I think the developmental state paradigm will become a myth. Thanks a lot for your
attention. Now, there's a nice tradition that we don't work lecturers too hard in an inaugural lecture. So, although I'm sure loads of you are itching to ask questions, what I'm going to suggest is that you pose the questions to Joseph face to face over a glass of wine in the comparative warmth of the Jessel room. And it's all waiting for you there. But this has been a real tour de force, a wonderful lecture, a great way to launch the Emeka Nyuku visiting professor in Commonwealth Studies. So Mayor, from the bottom of my heart, thank you, Joseph, for being here in the Institute and giving this wonderful lecture to us all today. And I hope you'll all join us for a glass of wine. But first, let's thank Joseph once again.